Another gangplank, another country, another customs hall. After 3 days on the Black Sea and 2.5 weeks in the Soviet Union, Istanbul comes as quite a shock to the system. I feel disoriented, as crumpled and travel-worn as the equipment we've lugged 5,000 miles from the frozen north.
Well, I just put them down there.
If the Soviet Union was the land of niet, Turkey is the land of yes, please, how many do you want? Everything is available, in all sizes.
Pera Palace. Intimate. Thank you.
The car is, well, generous. Then it occurred to me I might have made a terrible mistake.
This is a taxi, is it?
Not the president's car. Teach him to park in a taxi, right?
In one journey, we probably used half the country's oil reserves. But at least I'm within sight of a wash and brush up. The hotel is famous, but not as famous as its occupants. I'm given the very room in which Agatha Christie wrote Murder on the Orient Express. Has she any message, perhaps, for a fellow writer? The Pera Palas Hotel was built in the grand optimistic style before accountants ruled the world. Every detail of its splendid interior is probably more expensive than it need have been. It's a relic of the day when this was a predominantly European city, more Constantinople than Istanbul. The trams that run along Pera Street, indeed Pera Street itself, still reflect the acceptable face of Western commerce. But the city is filling up fast. In 30 years, the population has grown from under 1 million to over 8 million people. Most of them cannot afford to shop on Pera Street. Outside the university, people from all over Eastern Europe are trading on the edge of the law, exchanging goods in the spirit, if not the currency, of this great commercial city. Azerbaijanis sell to Poles, Armenians to Romanians. It looks furtive and dangerous, but it's often disappointingly mundane. What's this? Ah. A toy train ring. The truth is that Istanbul has always been one great bazaar. It's a city dedicated to buying and selling. And why change when there are mugs coming along every day?
It's nice. It's Turkish kilim.
Turkish kilim.
Yes. It's new.
Is it very expensive?
Cheap price.
Cheap?
Yes.
How much?
$150.
I'll just have a little look up here and then maybe I'll come back.
Okay.
Okay.
We can make it cheaper.
Mm. You make it cheaper?
Yes. $125.
Good. I think we'll talk later.
Goodbye.
You're from?
Good morning.
From? Maybe from
London.
Melbourne.
London.
Oh, I was in London.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Like were you selling carpets?
Do you speak? Yes.
In London?
No, I was in holiday in London.
Oh,
my
holiday.
Business is I pray in the mosque, the church.
You pray in the,
yes,
in the mosque?
Yes, for the Islamic people.
Ah, are you a
imam.
Are you an imam?
Yes.
Oh, really?
I am imam. Yes, imam.
But if you're an imam, aren't you working all the time in the mosque?
Every day, five times.
But
I'm sick from Allahu Akbar. God is big. Come to pray.
But you lead the people.
Yes, yes. I lead every people.
What are you doing here today, then? You also sell carpets?
This shop's is my friend 30 years.
I'm going to have a little look down here, okay?
Yes.
Maybe I'll come back. Oh, it's your shop as well, is it? Yeah.
This carpet
that's
is,
a big
this
one.
This is
that,
8
yeah.
meters.
8 meters.
In Germany money, 1,500 Deutsche Mark.
1,500 Deutschmark, that's about sort of threes into that's about £500. Okay, I may come back.
Thank you.
Inshallah. Yes, inshallah.
Mind you, there's more to Istanbul than carpets. There are men in false moustaches who can't march straight. These are the Janissaries, an ancient and elite corps who mount guard at the Topkapi Palace. Their job was to protect the Sultan, but they were always recruited from Christian rather than Muslim ranks, presumably to guarantee impartiality. They're certainly the best-dressed bouncers I've ever seen. The Blue Mosque rates highly in the minaret-conscious world of Islam. It has no less than 6. But the finest building in Istanbul is, for me, the Mosque of Suleiman the Magnificent. It has a cemetery in which lie the remains of illustrious courtiers. The gravestones are said to be the same height as the occupants of the grave. Except in the case of Suleiman's massive tomb. He was magnificent, but surely not this big. Headstones denote the rank and fame of once great men. Humbler modern worshippers still use the 400-year-old mosque for their 5 times daily prayers. Ablutions are very much a part of the Islamic tradition, so when in Rome...
Hello. I'd like really the best treatment you have, the full treatment. Which is that?
Number 5.
Number 5? Mm-hmm. Treatment fit for a sultan.
Somebody wash and somebody makes massage.
Okay. Thank you.
This emporium of cleanliness is the Jalalu Hamamu, one of the oldest Turkish baths in the world. In 300 years of continuous business, it claims to have cleaned, among others, Tony Curtis, Kaiser Wilhelm, and Florence Nightingale. I wonder where she put the lamp.
Good?
Yeah.
Good,
so far, so good.
My masseur is a man of few words, but many pounds.
Very friendly steamroller. Being a lawn that's being rolled. It's good for me. Ah,
Then it's time for the washing up. In this case, I am the washing up.
Okay. Yeah, come on, come on.
My friend is using what they describe as a hand-knitted oriental washcloth. But I can think of a better description.
Ah, wash very good.
This is the Brillo pad moment. I've been waiting for.
Wash, yeah?
Sandpapery surface.
Is that
my dirt,
or yours?
That's the dirt off me.
This is embarrassing. I had a mud bath in Odessa. That's probably what this is all about.
I'm sure that's what they all say. It's a long, thorough process. At least it'll mean I shan't have to wash again till Cape Town. Having been comprehensively washed and squashed, I repair to the waterfront for an evening meal. The food's good, cheap, wholesome, and you never need to book a table.
Beautifully done. Beautifully done. What a service. Thank you.
It's time to move on, and we catch the ferry to what my school atlas always referred to as Asia Minor. I should be admiring the skyline, but there's something more stunning this morning, and it's in the newspaper. There's been a coup in Russia. Gorbachev has gone, arrested. I think of all the friends we made there. If this is true, things can only be worse for them. For us lucky ones, life goes on. We've escaped from the USSR by the skin of our teeth. Our route along 30 degrees now takes us from Istanbul, down through Turkey, to the shores of the Aegean, the Mediterranean, and the mouth of the Nile. On a day of such momentous news, it seems suitable that our short trip across Asia takes us down through a land where so much history has been made. Troy and Ephesus lie just over those hot, stony hills. We haven't time to be tourists. We must find our way as rapidly as possible across the Mediterranean. We don't stop until we've reached the port of Marmaris on what they call the turquoise coast of southern Turkey. There are plenty of boats in the harbour, but none of them seem to be going beyond the next bay. The The Greek island of Rhodes, 50 miles south, seems about as far as we'll get from here. What should be an idyllic journey across one of the most well-sailed seas in the world is becoming an unexpected frustration. The trouble is, we've struck the holiday time of year and no one wants to go very far, very fast. On landing at Rhodes, I pass by the postcards and make straight for the shipping office. For Cyprus and Israel, every Friday. That's tomorrow. With a day to kill, I book in at a hotel of character on a quiet back street. Well, it was quiet before I booked in. There's a lot of history I don't know much about here in Rhodes, so I seek out Vangelis Pavlivis, local-born cartoonist of an Athens newspaper.
You can see what's going on here. It's a sorting out of...
Well, that's everybody fighting for Rhodes, OK? Yeah. You know, it was a coveted place, so...
I love that. I mean, you obviously love the architecture and the buildings, but the actual, the knights themselves seem to be treated fairly comically.
Well, you know, there were funny characters in their own way.
The island of Rhodes has always attracted tourists, many of them with very large armies. Spartans, Athenians, Romans, Turks and Italians all visited, but the Knights of St. John left the most indelible mark.
This is the Street of the Knights. It's supposed to be the oldest street in the whole of Greece, 4th century BC. But of course now the buildings we see around, they're from the 14th, 15th century when the Knights of St. John came here.
Oh, they're beautiful. I mean, they're sort of quite palatial. What were they?
Well,
they've been used.
They were meant to be, yes, because they are the hostels of the different nationalities, the different tongues, you know, of the knights that were staying here. So you have, you know, the different, you know, you have France, you have Italy, you have the hostel of England, you know, all along this the street. And at the top, you have the palace of the Grand Master.
This Christian frontier they defended so zealously fell in 1522 to the Muslim army of our old friend Suleiman the Magnificent. Battles nowadays are most likely to be fought for places on the beach, and the invaders who do stay are happy to look at castles rather than build them. In the village of Lindos, I pay a visit to someone who's made a future here.
Hello.
How are you?
Patrick Walker, Michael Palin. Thank you.
Lovely to see you.
Come in. Can you give me some advice?
Of course, come in.
Can you give it publicly before these people?
No, privately.
All right, it's a private consultation.
Few Englishmen influence the great British public more than Patrick Walker the astrologer. Now, as we make our faltering way across the Mediterranean, I feel I need some guidance.
In general, is this a good time to be making a pole-to-pole journey?
In general, yes. Specifically at the moment, I'm slightly surprised that you're here at all, in that I thought you would have probably been held up along the way.
Yes, I mean, we're quite surprised to be here, but we are here. Now, why? What are you keeping from us?
Since August the 8th, a thing called... a retrograde Mercury. It's when the planet Mercury appears to be travelling backwards in the heavens. It isn't, but it appears to be. And between August 8th and September 2nd, this is going on, and it's a time when all forms of communication and travel plans tend to be disrupted. It hasn't finished yet, you see. It's usually the last few days of those 3 weeks that tend to be the trickiest.
What else can go wrong?
Where will you be in those last few days, the very last of August?
Well, around Cairo and port side, round about that time. So what would your advice be to us? To stay here?
No. Oh, yes. No.
It blows over.
No. No. It's just to prepare, have alternative plans, that's it, really. Is there any other way you can go?
Mm.
Retrograde Mercury notwithstanding, we successfully squeeze our way onto a ferry carrying holidaymakers from Athens back to Israel. The trouble is, seeing holidaymakers makes me think of time off, and time off makes me think of home, and home makes me think of, well, holidays. Cyprus by the sea, where the British garrison maintains our military presence in the Mediterranean. But today is bank holiday, and they're on cream tea alert.
Can I join you? It's fully booked.
I mean, we can't stop long because somebody bought them.
Yeah, it's popular, isn't it? Very popular, this tea tent.
Despite temperatures close to 100, people are playing cricket. One man I spoke to was off to referee a football match.
Everybody here seems to do sport day in and day out. Is there any sort of military life here, or is that an illusion?
Illusion sometimes, yeah. I think the forces is a hobby, and it revolves around sport more than anything. Sport is played, I should admit, well, nearly every day, and it's a great life.
But because we're here in a very hot country, we tend to finish work normally by 1:30 in the afternoon, having started at 7. So most afternoons, apart from Monday, are free for sport.
What happened during the Gulf War, and this would obviously have been in the front line almost?
Well, it was very difficult, of course, especially during the early days when we were particularly busy here at Akrotiri. But throughout, we were busy anyway. But sport becomes even more important under those circumstances. People are working hard, need to get away, they need to be able to get some recreation. And so not only cricket, but rugby and football and all the rest didn't stop, but obviously had to come second to the operation.
Cyprus, like Rhodes, has seen empires come and go. The British have brought their playing fields, kept green and watered by the miracle of treated effluent. The Romans and Greeks left their temples and amphitheatres and legends, like that of Aphrodite's birthplace, a rock which stands off the coast. Swim three times round it at full moon and you'll live forever. Meanwhile, Cypriot life, unbothered by great events and great pretensions, maintains its own rituals and traditions. Today there's a wedding in the village of Polemi near Paphos, and it's not going to be a quiet affair.
Στον δούλο του Θεού Πολυκαρπών, εις το όνομα του Πατρός και του Υιού και του Αγίου Πνεύματος. Στέφεται η δούλη του Θεού Αριάδνη, στον δούλο του Θεού Πολυκαρπών, εις το όνομα του Πατρός και του Υιού και του Αγίου Πνεύματος. Κύριε ο Θεός ημών, δόξη και τιμή στεφάνος ον αυτός.
Κύριε ο Θεός ημών, δόξη και...
Ariadne Kyriakou is marrying Polycarpus Polycarpou. They are the stars of a long and spectacular show. First on the bill is the baby rolling act, which wishes happiness and fertility on the marital bed.
Oh.
Then there's the welcoming of the guests, which is more of an endurance test than you might think.
How many people are you expecting tonight?
We expect about 3,000.
3,000?
Yeah, at least. 3,000.
You have to provide food and drink for them?
Yeah.
Must be very expensive for somebody.
It is, yeah. It may cost £10,000.
Really?
Cyprus pounds, yeah.
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 And who pays for that?
The family of both groom and bride, yeah.
I'm amazed you've still got a suit and a tie.
Yeah. Yeah.
The financial blow must be softened by the tradition that no guest arrives empty-handed.
Thank you, congratulations.
Thanks.
The celebrations expand to fill the largest public space in the village. And the money keeps rolling in. Miss Petty Cash, 1991. Dancing continues into the night under the beady eye of the widows they call blackbirds. Old-fashioned weddings like this one don't happen much anymore. I hope Ariadne and Polycarpus have a long life together. If it's anywhere near as long as their wedding, they should be fine. Slowly the sun rises to reveal Africa. Our third continent in 7 days, our home for months ahead. Egypt is out there, but no one's quite sure how to get to it. Loch Ness monster of a pontoon is towed towards us, and the fun begins.
Hello. Want to buy a nice wallet for you? Nice wallet?
Within minutes of disembarking, we're in trouble. Our camera tripod rolls into the Mediterranean. Solutions are strong on enthusiasm, but low on practicality. Later, much later.
Well, the tripod has been retrieved by a diver from 60 feet down in the Mediterranean mud, but that's only been the start of the problems. Passepartout has had to spend 7 hours in customs, and that effectively means we've wasted a whole day's filming. Now, some say, well, that's Africa for you. Things like this are bound to happen. And astrologers would say, well, Mercury's in retrograde. Patrick Walker warned you. Well, I don't know who's right, but we're going to go to Cairo and take things easy, keep out of Mercury's way. But we will take a few pictures of ships going through the Suez Canal on the way. Inshallah. Ships on the Suez Canal, as good as our word.
The Egyptian effect begins to take over. It involves finding the nearest bench, sitting down, and accepting that there's nothing whatever you can do about anything. God will provide. Yeah. It's a philosophy which helps out here, especially in Cairo. This is Ramses Station.
Excuse me, do you know the train to Luxor?
Yeah.
Luxor? Luxor, yeah.
Number 8.
Number what?
Number 9.
Right through that arch.
This arch? Not from camp.
Luxor, overnight train.
Number 9.
Okay.
Eight or nine?
Nine. He works here, you know. You say 8?
Yes.
He says 9.
Yes. But it's man.
Well, he works here, doesn't he?
Yes, yeah.
Well, you say platform 8 for Luxor.
Luxor?
Yeah.
Yes, one bomb, platform number 11.
11?
11.
Anyone else?
Yeah.
Luxor, 11, 8, 9. Which is the platform for Luxor? The night train. Sorry. Did it say it up there?
Yes, Alexandria.
What number, platform?
11.
11.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes, yes.
Not 8 or 9,
yes.
11. Where's 11? Through there?
Yeah, bullet's map.
Okay, thank you.
I find the train, eventually, at platform 10.
Which number?
7 and 8.
Which, down here?
Down here, yeah.
Thank you.
When I last left Cairo, I was trying to get round the world in 80 days. I took a taxi east into the desert. Tonight I'm facing the infinitely more enticing prospect of a journey south, down the Nile for the first time in my life. 440 miles south of Cairo is Luxor, where my home for the next few days is moored on the Nile itself. The scale and power of the buildings here is greater than anything I was prepared for. And Tadarus, my Coptic Christian guide, seems to know everybody there is to know.
Well, the pharaohs are your ancestors. Are you descended from the pharaohs?
Sure. Coptic means the Egyptian.
Coptic means?
Egyptian.
Ah.
Pure and Egyptian.
The floor would have been like this, would it?
No, the floor in that time, it must be made of precious stones.
You mean all this would be covered with precious stones, what we're walking on now?
Yes.
In the hypostyle hall at Karnak, elaborate hieroglyphics recount the deeds of the god kings 3,000 years ago. 2,800 years later, we no longer needed hieroglyphics. We developed graffiti. This extraordinary collection of massive stone columns built to symbolize a forest is just one room. How could they build like this at a time when we in Britain were still on stone circles? Tadarus knew Howard Carter, the man who uncovered Tutankhamun's tomb.
When I asked Mr. Howard Carter how they, well, they bring it from Aswan quarry, but I tell him how they put it on its base. Mm. We get very modern cranes. He said, we get very modern cranes. It can shift more than 200 tons. Mm. He said, maybe by magic.
No magic.
Yeah, Moses, when he met Pharaoh, he threw his stick like that. Stick of Moses became snake. That's magic.
On the other side of the Nile is the Valley of the Kings, an inhospitable, sun-bleached canyon, beneath which was stored a treasure house of immeasurable wealth, the tombs of 62 pharaohs.
And how many have been found? How many tombs have been
40.
Found?
40. And unfortunately, nothing be found in the 40 tombs. Already robbed by the robbers, except Tutankhamun.
So the 22 tombs still to be discovered?
Yeah, not yet.
When this tomb was discovered, Peter, what was in it?
In
1892, yeah. What was in it?
Nothing.
Why?
Robbed by the robbers.
They've just taken everything?
Really, I don't like to say robbed. Because since long nobody cared about the monuments.
You've actually been present when Tutankhamun's tomb was discovered by Howard Carter.
Yeah.
A lot of people say that there was a curse no on curse. Those who saw the tomb. What
no
do you
curse,
think?
No curse at all.
How can you
Newspapers,
be so sure?
Newspapers, they wrote whatever they like. They like to make it good story, that's all.
But someone said a mosquito flew out of the tomb.
No mosquito, yeah. They said there's a mosquito came out on the tomb and bite him and he died. No, no, that's not it. Well, you know, he discovered the tomb in 1922. He stayed inside the tomb up to 1927. And he returned back to England in 1927. He died in 1989. He died a very, very old man.
Peter, can you show me now some of the carvings here and tell me what they all mean? Who are they on?
In this one tomb, here, Ramses said, the carving is very deep carving.
Who this is Ramses.
Ramses said, why, he's wearing the false beard.
Why?
High priest.
Why are they always in profile? Why are they never
They
facing
look
it?
Nice in profile.
Ah, it's a design. Cultural cruises down the Nile have become big business in the last 10 years. But the Gulf War has scared customers away, and there are only 30 passengers aboard the Isis as we move at a leisurely pace towards Aswan. But the culture we've paid to see is the culture of 3,000 years ago. The realities of life in modern Egypt hardly impinge on our cocoon of comfort. At Esna, we run into something I hadn't expected, a Nile traffic jam. The bottleneck is caused by a lock, which can only accommodate one ship an hour. Delays of up to 2 days have been known. The local retailers mount an amphibious operation. A squadron of boutiques takes to the water. Others attack from the land, literally bombarding us with bargains.
Is it all sizes?
£1 for looking.
Oh, wait a minute, wait a minute. £1 for looking. Ah. Wait. Oh. Oh. Is it waterproof?
Right, there we go. Let's have a look. Monsieur.
Yeah. Now, anyone else? Right, what is it? £10. £10 for them.
Not too much. Not too much for you.
Not my colour.
Why no?
Close.
Here we are.
Cut. How much?
£1.
Huh?
£1.
£1?
£1. My final offer.
£1 for right.
Why you laugh?
Okay.
What's funny,
man?
A free look. Is that a free look?
Let's see.
Oh my God.
No obligation.
20 to 2.
Thank you.
Oh. Give me £5 for our picture.
We have a 7-hour delay, and an educational trip is hastily arranged. We don't get far.
£35. Yeah. I bought one better than that for £20 on the boat up there.
Excellent. That's just
Scotland. Yes, it was. It was jolly good.
This is first cotton.
No, that was first cotton. I bought up there. Yeah, £10.
Impossible in life.
Okay, oh, well. Give me 20 English money.
Huh? 20, you? 20 not on your Nelly, no.
How much for three?
Eventually, we fight our way through to the Temple of Kom Ombo, dedicated suitably to the sacred crocodile. It's hot among the colonnades and the hypostyle halls, and the strain's beginning to tell on those working at the frontiers of technology.
It's not clicked on, Gerald. I've done everything properly. Don't start naturally.
Portions of the drawing.
For some people, the search for knowledge is uncompromising. For others, a bit of temple fatigue is setting in.
You like the guided bit of the tours?
As long as it's not too much. Well, I think it's proved that you, after 20 minutes, the mind goes blank, doesn't it? Yeah. I mean, I proved that at school.
Pat and Gerald are from Sheffield, but they're citizens of the world.
Oh, that's true. In Brazil, it's even better. You can sit in a cafe and the shop comes to you. Buy anything you like, sat in a cafe in Brazil.
You've been out. Where haven't you been?
The end of the day is for peace and contemplation, a time to surrender to the soothing magic of the Nile sunset. Unless, of course, it happens to be fancy dress night. It's billed as the highlight of your trip, which certainly puts Egypt in its place.
Mr. Gerald Flinders.
I'm Henry VIII, I am. Henry VIII, I am, I am. I've been married to the widow next door. She'd been married seven times before. All the ones were a Henry. They wouldn't have a Willie or a Sam. Underneath the arches, I dream my dreams away.
Tell folks that.
There's no escape. Everyone's expected to dress up. Even actors.
I'd like to lower the tone of the evening by attempting to recite the great work of Percy Bysshe Shelley, the poem Ozymandias. I met a stranger from an antique land who said, two vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert.
Aswan marks the end of the tourist trail. Those who venture south from here do so at their own risk. The ferryboat Sinai takes everyone who wants to travel and their possessions. I've never seen so many people trying to get on a ship. No turning back now. From here on, everything is new, unfamiliar, and very confusing. As Egypt slips away, so does any remaining hope of predictability. The journey ahead should be simple enough. Across Lake Nasser to Wadi Halfa, where we take a train for Khartoum and south to the heart of Africa. But of course, it isn't as easy as that.
The whole point about this ferry is it only exists to connect with a train in Wadi Halfa, which is in the Sudan, Aswan being in Egypt. And the train service used to run to Khartoum daily. Then it changed to weekly. And we just heard a few days ago that it was now going to run fortnightly. But no one had told the ferry company. So we actually had to arrange a meeting between the governor of Wadi Halfa and the chairman of the ferry company to actually get this ferry going. So it's partly our work that this ferry is going at all. We will get to Wadi Halfa in the Sudan, we hope, where we have heard that the train we connect with is now running every month. So, you know, this is Africa. And on Lake Nasser, schedules are flexible.
Life on board the Sinai is remarkable for its tolerance. No one seems to complain about lack of space. Unfortunately, no one else has yet found the reading room. I settle down to do a bit of preparatory research. I wish I hadn't. From what I can tell, just about anything you eat in Africa could kill you. There's so little room on board that the restaurant is also the immigration office. They'll serve you a salad and stamp your passport.
What kind of soup is that?
Chicken.
Okay, not all at once. Not all at once. Too much. Right, thank you. Shukran.
Salat.
Oh, nice.
Bread.
Spoon. No cutlery on this plate. Thank you. Oh, that's nice.
Salat.
Great, thank you. Thanks.
The food's rather tasty, and it turns out I'm eating it at the captain's table.
Good.
I have a good wife.
Really? Yeah.
So do I.
Yes.
Very important in this life, isn't it?
Lovely. Mm.
Egyptian wife.
Mm-hmm. Only one. Mm.
You've only one?
Yeah. Doesn't somebody have more?
I hope so, too. Yeah.
No, you can't. I'm Muslim and I can't.
Well, if you've got one that's just right, then that's fine. You don't want any more.
Next morning, the port of Wadi Halfa lies ahead of us. It looks about as promising as my guidebook's description of the country we're approaching. The Sudan is fraught with turmoil, economic chaos, civil war, drought, famine, and refugee crisis. I can't wait.
Neither can we. Escape with BBC iPlayer. Adventure is guaranteed with Race Across the World streaming now. And in 10 minutes, stylish, compelling, thrilling, The Bridge continues at 9.